Right. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Spring 2023. Hope you had a blessed holiday season. Wishing each one of you a blessed new year as well. So this semester, we'll be talking about marketplace ministry. And the book that we'll be covering is The Timeless Principles for the Workplace, which is Pastor Ashish's publication, Timeless Principles for the Workplace. So I've posted the notes on the stream, so feel free to download them. And even as we track along, you can probably have the notes open so that you can, you know, make your personal notes as well. Right, so before we begin, let's just start this semester with a word of prayer. Let's just surrender this entire semester. Let's pray and ask God for wisdom, even as we learn together, that the Lord will truly minister to us throughout the course of this entire subject. Right, so can any one of us please pray? Jafina, can you pray, please?
Yes, Pastor. Good morning, Pastor. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you under the name of Jesus. We thank you for this beautiful day and for the new beginning in our lives, Jesus. As we are starting this new semester with you, as we are starting this new subject with you, God, we pray that you'll be the Alpha and the Omega, guiding us throughout the semester, being with us, giving us all the knowledge and wisdom that we need, so that we can understand who you are, we can understand a little more about you, we can get a little more closer to you each and every day, and we can do some great things for your kingdom down here on this earth. I bless each and every one of our students. I bless our faculties. Be with them and guide them. Give us all that we need, good life connections, our health, our mental health. I give everything into your hands, Jesus. I pray that this semester will be a blessing to us, and this will help us to edify ourselves more in you, equip ourselves more in you, so that we can be the salt and light to this world. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Thank you, Jafina. So welcome once again, everyone. Let's just begin today's course. So this semester, the classes are spread out at two different hours. So we have Monday, first hour, and Wednesday, the third hour, right? So so we can see how it goes, right? So if you have downloaded your notes, you can have them open as well. So we look at this book, The Timeless Principles for the Workplace. Now, this book has a lot of material in terms of the workplace, but I know that some of us are still in college, or some of them are still yet to enter the professional, the workplace area. But these are principles that each one of us can apply in not only our professional life, but also in our personal lives, our family lives. And we'll be talking about different aspects of, the whole aspect of having principles, right? And when we look at the Bible, when we look at scriptures, when we look at the men and women that God has used in the Bible, and even after that, in the early church, they were men and women who had certain principles. And we as believers, and if God has called us for a purpose, we must have certain principles, and we must stand by them, right? So let's go to the first chapter, personal vision and purpose, right? So here are just a few principles that we can start off with to remember. First one, you and I were made for a purpose. And we need to discover it, we need to live it. Right? So Ephesians 2:10 says, God has made us what we are. And in our union with Christ Jesus, he has created us for a life of good deeds, which he has already prepared for us to do. So wonderful. God has designed us, created us for a purpose. Now, here's something important. I'm sure you, each one of us, would have heard this over the years. There is a general purpose, right, that God has created us for, right? And that general purpose is to glorify God, to know Him personally, to walk in His principles, to walk in obedience to the Word of God, to worship God. That is a general purpose that each and every human being has. But there are specific purposes that God gives to each individual, right? Some are called to be engineers, some are called to be doctors, some are called to be pastors, some are called to be in the government, in music, in all different kinds of spheres of influence. But these specific purposes of God include what we become professionally, which means our, when we say, you know, many a times we say full-time ministry. Oh, I'm not in full-time ministry. Actually, there is no full-time ministry and part-time ministry. If God has called you to be a doctor, it is God's calling on your life. So it is a ministry because you're doing it unto the Lord. Right? So it's no more part-time or full-time. So our work life does not separate from what God wants us to do, God's specific purpose for our lives. Both are together, right? So even when if we begin our professional careers, and it could be something that is not related to the Bible at all, but we must understand that we must walk in the principles of what the Bible teaches us. So each step we take, we live out with a divine purpose, right? So some of us may just be teachers, or some of us could be, Monday to Friday, just working in a corporate job, 9 to 5. And we may feel, oh God, I wish I was in full-time ministry. But I want to bring this, very important point. If God has called you to be in the corporate sector, that is your call. That is your ministry, right? And if we know the why, the what, and the how, then everything else will follow. Meaning, when we know that, okay, I am, whatever I'm doing it unto the Lord. When we know that, there's a great sense of purpose, right? And we know how to get there, right? So our foundation is really what matters, right? So whether in the corporate, whether in ministry, right? What I will do throughout this course is try and bring in some examples from the corporate world and also in terms of ministry. I mean, interrelate them to see how God is interested in everyone, not just, okay, oh, because he's a pastor, so God is more interested in him, or because he's leading a ministry. No. God's purpose for us, whatever he has for us, he is interested in that purpose for our lives. Right? Let's read Matthew chapter 7, verse 24 through 26. Yes, any one of us can read that. Matthew chapter 7, 24 to 26. It's on your notes. Matthew 24 to 26. Let's go ahead.
Matthew chapter 7, verse 24 to 27. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall.
Right. Thank you, Rosalind. So now Jesus is talking here and he's teaching his disciples. He's talking to them about the importance of foundation, right? He's saying, okay, if anyone has to build a house, the foundation needs to be right. Right now, if you look at these huge apartment complexes or these tall buildings, the higher you want the apartment or the building, the deeper you need to go in. Right? The foundation needs to be really down. Right? So if you want to go 20 floors, you got to go at least 20 to 30 feet down. Right? If you want to go 30, 40 floors, you just got to go deeper. So the higher the building, the deeper the foundation must be. And here Jesus is bringing this very practical example, but a powerful example. And basically what Jesus is saying is, what you build on, which is our foundation, matters, right? Now, just like in the natural, if you're building a 20-floor building, you can't have a 5 feet foundation. If you build on that, what's going to happen? Over time, you'll find cracks on the wall. Over time, it's just going to crumble down. It's not going to last for long, right? But the same way, in spiritually, our spiritual foundation is very important, right? We must, you know, in terms of our spiritual life, make sure our foundation is strong, right? Now, good foundations are important both for ministry and for a professional life. Take time to lay the foundation, right? And I always give this example, right? An architect, he's going to draw a beautiful house. Say, okay, this is where your bedrooms are, this is where your hall room is, the living room, and the dining area, this is going to be a balcony. It looks beautiful, right? The outcome looks beautiful, right? The architect draws it. But then, when the foundation is starting, nobody is going to come and say, oh, such a beautiful foundation. It looks so nice. No, there's nothing beautiful about it. Right? It's just sand and rubble which you're taking out of the ground. But that is so important to make that beautiful structure, you know, to stand there. Now, we as believers must take time and effort to have a good foundation, both professionally and spiritually. Now, I remember when I completed my studies, I wanted to work for a while. Right? I wanted to, before I could finish my degree, I wanted to work. So I joined a company. And when I joined there, it was, you know, there was a couple of hours, there would be calls, and the other half of the next 4 hours would be just working on back-end related work. Now, I knew that if I have to, you know, if it was calling customers, talking to customers, and these are high-end customers who are very well off, right? So I knew that if I had to get to speak to these high-end corporate companies, leaders, I cannot do with average English. I need to be, my rapport, the way I speak, the way I communicate with them should be spot on. So I used to, practice my calls. Right? So I would close the room and I would practice the call. Right? Good evening, we're calling from here, and practice the whole call flow. I would do that every single day for at least 2 hours. Right? Now, there's nothing spiritual about it, but I would do that. What happened was, when I went on to, take calls, I began to notice that, hey, I'm able to communicate. I'm able to talk to them. I'm able to understand their accent. These were American clients, so I was able to understand their accent. I was able to understand their jargons. I also began to read a lot of American language books, started to listen to a lot of English, teaching sessions in American English. So I did all of that. And I remember over time, 6 months into the, after I joined the job, 6 months, I got a promotion. They said, you become a senior, executive. Now, was this important? Yes. Because I knew that this is what I'm going to be doing. I'm going to be talking to people. Now, the same thing in ministry, right? It could be, preaching and teaching or reading the Word of God, preparing sermons. This is what we have to do, right? Take time and effort to lay a good foundation. The problem is sometimes right now when we look around, people immediately want the stage or they immediately want to be in the front line. And that's usually not how God works, right? He helps us to transition in life. And as we move from phase to phase, from season to season, remember, each season requires a foundation, right? Now, these foundations can also mean setting up good standards for yourself, right? So the moment I got into the ministry, I knew some things. I set certain standards. Okay, this is what I will do. This is what I will do. These things I will not do. I'm not going to talk about other ministries. I'm not going to gossip. I'm not going to, just because others may say things, I mean, I will not do it. I set certain standards. What am I doing? I'm building a good foundation. So over time, maybe 5 years into ministry, people may say things or people may ridicule. But it's not going to affect you because your foundations are strong. Right? Do the important. Work first and then plan for comforts. Right? Basically meaning don't be too hungry for success or money. Success and money comes from the Lord. And it will come in the right way at the right time. Success, that is hard work earned success, is so tasteful to the mouth than success earned by wrong methods or wrong motives, right? So each one of us, let us lay a good foundation. Maybe some of us may feel, hey, my foundation is not too strong. It's all right. Go back, build on that foundation, right? And regardless of which area of work, you may be teachers, working professional, engineers, doctors, set good foundations, set good principles in the beginning of your career, right? Now, it's never too late to go back and, restart. It's never too late. And when we do these things, have time management, problem solving, decision making, understanding finances, by planning, organizing, organization, and leading. All these are very important, right? Gain knowledge and develop skills, right? So if it is something to do with, if you want to be a teacher, you got to do your course. You got to do, extra research, extra studies. Reading more books and a lot of research. Or if you want to be somebody who joins the government sector, so you've got to do what is involved there, right? Understanding what is the government, what is happening there, and we must develop habits, right? That can align us into what God wants us to do. And some of the important things is time management. Of course, even as we go over the course, we'll learn this a little more in detail as well. Time management. I don't have time. I'm working. I have a family. I'm not able to manage. Right? And we'll talk about that as well. Feel free to stop me if you have any questions anywhere in between. Otherwise, I'll just keep going on. Right. Your personal priorities are foundational. Let's read Mark chapter 12 and verse 30, which is on your notes. Mark 12 and verse 30. Yes, any one of us can read. Mark chapter 12 and verse 30.
Mark chapter 12, verse 30, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. Amen.
Yes, thank you, Divya. Now, this is a commandment which the Lord Jesus is giving. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength. Right? Now, in addition to laying a good foundation, what is very, very, very important is personal character, our values and attitudes that we carry. Very important, right? Because we may have a lot of skill, a lot of talents, and God may have given us these wonderful opportunities, right? And in God, because of our skills and talents, we're going up the ladder. But remember, we can go up the ladder, and if our character is bad, we're just going to fall down. Right? And we look at many organizations, many leaders who have gone really high up, maybe the highest rank in their respective fields. But because of personal character, because of no values or attitudes, they have just fallen down. Knowing and establishing your personal priorities are very important, right? Loving God, worshiping Him, serving Him must be priority in our lives. And out of that comes an outflow of everything that we do, right? If family is important, then you have to give opportunity, you have to give importance to your family as well, right? So as believers, we must understand that God has given us both work and family. And these there should be a balance between both of them, right? Build your character, have certain values, have certain attitudes that you know when you grow in your ministry or grow in your work, that you will stand on those principles, right? So be clear of non-negotiables, right? And we'll talk about that. Now, Luke 9:62 says, but Jesus said to them, no one, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. So what are these non-negotiables? Now, in the corporate sector, there is plenty of non-negotiables. Right, we can sell out for the sake of money, professional benefits. You know, there could be integrity problems, honesty problems. There could be people who are money laundering, bribing. All these things are there. Now, you and I can be clear of certain things, certain non-negotiables. This is. No matter, so for example, if somebody says, hey, can we bribe this person so that they can, you know, give us the papers and just sign off for us and then we can continue to do our work? No, it's a non-negotiable. I remember this one person, maybe almost a year back, he works in this real estate, you know, in our nation of India now. Now, to get certain documents signed off by ministers and all of that, there has to be a bribe paid. But this man was a good man. He's a good man. He didn't want to pay a bribe and he wanted to do it clearly. So he said to me, see, if I wait for the signatures, it's going to take me 1 year or 2 years. But if I bribe, it'll take me a month. And within a month, I can start the construction work. So he asked me, what should I do? So I said, yeah, this is what I said to him. I said, if you start off by paying bribe, what is the foundation you're building your, you know, the structure on? The foundation is that you've got all this paperwork through bribery. Right? Now, is it going to be a blessing or is it going to be a curse? He said, yeah, of course, it's not going to be a blessing because I've done it the wrong way. So I said, you pray. Ask God to, you know, open the right doors, and you ask God to give you, tell God that you will not do this. These are some non-negotiables, and hold fast to that. Now, I remember this person, it took him about 3 months, but without paying a bribe, he got his. So if we stand on certain, be clear on certain non-negotiables, whether the situation is a small situation or a big situation, this is where you have to draw your strength from, the foundations that you have set up in your life, right? There's no pressure, right? Look at the example of Daniel. What a powerful example. He was about 17 years old. He comes into a Jew, came into Babylon, looking after things in the king's temple. He served three kings. And during the third empire, the Persian king, Darius, he was falsely accused, and they were going to throw him into the lion's den. The Bible says that he went, he opened the windows towards Jerusalem, and he prayed as usual. Why? Because his foundations were strong. He was probably about 17 years old when he came into Babylon. From that time onwards, every day, three times in a day, he would open the windows, look towards Jerusalem, and pray. There was no negotiables on that. So even when he knew that he was going to be thrown into the lion's den, it didn't change. Why? Because he drew his strength from the foundations that he set. Probably Daniel thought to himself, all right, now I'm going to Babylon. There's going to be all kinds of things happening there. There's all kinds of adultery, idolatry happening there. But I will set my life right in the eyes of God. There are certain things I will not do. I will not bow down before any other God. Principles, foundations that were set many, many years back. And so when the big situation came, when the problem came, all Daniel had to do was look back. Hey, this is the foundation. These are the principles I stand by. So there's no negotiations on this. And you and I will face challenges. Those challenges can be big, they can be small. But remember to draw from your foundation. Draw from your foundation. Draw from what you have set up in your early days. Right? Develop a life plan. Review it continuously. Now, Proverbs 21 verse 5. Careful planning puts you ahead in the long run. Hurry and scurry puts you further behind. Right? Now, if God has, you know, once we become believers, we understand that God has a call or a purpose for our lives, right? Now, the moment we know that, you and I can begin to develop a life plan. Now, this life plan can be a high-level plan. It can be a short-term plan. It can be 1 year. It can be 5 years. It can be a 10-year plan. And you can plan. You can prayerfully plan as to what you want to do, right? And how you want to get there, right? Now, over that 10 years, right, continue to review your plan. Look at it, right? So I remember I wrote a life plan when I was 25 years old. Right? I said 25 years old. I wrote a 10-year life plan. So I wrote, I'm just giving you this example, so maybe you can translate it to anything that you would like to, right? So I was already working in the corporate sector, but I wanted to do something in ministry. I knew that God had called me. So I began to write down, right? Write down meaning I put it on a Word document. And I said, okay, 10 years, 25 to 35, what do I want to do? So I said, okay, before, you know, just practical thing. You know, prayerfully, I wrote down. I said, okay, maybe in 2 years, I want to join a Bible college. I want to study the Word of God. Then after Bible college, I want to get married. After getting married, I want to serve the Lord. I want to join in any ministry and work. Right? So I want to, or I want to work and, you know, do the ministry together. Right? And by 30, I should be married with at least one kid. By 35, I must establish myself in ministry. I should be preaching and teaching God's word. So I wrote that when I was 25. Right? And of course, it was more elaborate. It was not just pointers. And then how am I going to do that? Right? If I have to quit my job and join a Bible college, I should have enough savings. I must have enough money to for 2 years, for the fees, for my expenses for the 2 years, if I'm staying in a hostel, or if I you know, I need money to travel up and down. And then, so everything had to be planned, right? I couldn't just leave. And after the Bible college, how do I start off? Where do I go? And so I began to write down everything, right? And wonderfully, God began to, it's not like I wrote it down, forgot about it, right? I kept opening it up, thinking about it, praying about it. Probably every day I would think about that plan, pray about it, ask God to open doors, give me the wisdom to choose the right step on how to do this. And over time, God just began to, you know, guide me to the right paths. Many a times I went the wrong way. And I could just sense God saying, no, don't go this way. Come back. Come back. Take this other turn. Take this way. It doesn't look right, but this is the way you must go. Right? And that's beautiful. Jeremiah 33:3 is a wonderful verse. It says, call to me and I will answer you. I'll tell you marvelous and wondrous things that you could never figure out on your own. The Message translation, again, beautiful. Right? You will not have all the details, but you will have a sense of direction. And this will help you in your life purpose, right? So I want to encourage each one of us, right? You may be even 40, it's all right. Or you may be in your 20s, right? Maybe you're just married, you don't know what to do ahead. Write down, right? You don't have to do it for 10 years. You can even do it for 2 years, or for 5 years, or for 1 year, right? But write down these purposes, develop a plan, and review it continuously. Right? Now, while you're doing that, three important facets that we must remember. Right? What kind of person God wants you to be? That means the person you want to be. Right? Obviously, if you start now, so 10 years from now, from 25 to 35, I didn't want to be the same person. Of course, I wanted to grow in the word. I wanted to grow in maturity and in the way I talk, in the way in my skills, and grow in my knowledge, my understanding of who God is, grow and develop as a person, right? Second is the place, meaning these could be geographical place or a professional place or where God wants to place you. Now, I had written, I want to work and do the ministry. And so I had written that. I very clearly remember work in the corporate sector, and then Saturday, Sunday, just serve, maybe, you know, start a life group or be there at church, serve in any area possible. So that was something I had decided. Right? So position yourself. Right, where do you want to see yourself? So I always looked at myself saying, okay, one day I will be a leader, if not a pastor or a preacher, but I will be somebody who can minister the word to others, because that's what I wanted to do, right? And the third one is the purpose, right? Why So the first one is the person. Second is the position or the place that God wants you to be. Third one is the purpose. What do you want God to release in and through your life? So if you want to be a doctor, why do you want to be a doctor? Or even if you want to be a doctor, how do you want God to use you through that? If you want to be an engineer, if you want to be somebody in the, working in the church, in the ministry, right? Now, God will release people into our lives as well to further His kingdom on earth. Right, so you and I need to have that passion, that zeal, right, to, you know, really release the things of God to whichever area of influence God has called us for. Your life plan is connected to the person that God wants you to be, the place He wants you to be positioned, and the purpose He wants to release through you. Right? Three things: the person, the place, and the purpose. So even as you write down, right, maybe your plan, so the person, okay, God, I want to be somebody who can grow more intimate and be more close to you, hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. That's the person I want to be. The place, God, I want to be in a place where I can minister to people every week. I'm just giving you an example. Third, the reason is I want to see people being healed of sicknesses, and I want to see people giving their lives to Christ. Then they may be, you know, they may see that God is real, that you are real. And God did this so beautifully in the life of Abraham. Look at Genesis 12, 1 to 3. I'll quickly read this. Now the Lord had said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Let's look at these three. The person. His name was Abram, which means father. But now God is saying, hey, I'm going to make you a greater person. You will be Abraham, and you will be the father of many nations. Two, I will take you to a place. Right? Now this place you will inherit. I will show you the land. This land is going to be a land flowing with milk and honey. And you, your descendants, everyone will live in that. Now here, it's a physical place, right? So not always God wants us to move to a physical place, right? But for Abraham, it was a move. Three, a purpose. So Abraham could have said, God, why can't I be here? No, purpose. You will be a blessing. And through you, all families of the earth will be blessed. God called Abraham, but he didn't know all the details yet. He had to journey in faith, right? So similarly, when you and I make plans, make strategies for our life, we may not know all the details, but we journey along with God, right? And I can share of plenty of examples where I never thought that this could happen, but no. Along the journey, it was God who did it for me, right? Look at the life of Apostle Paul. He had the great encounter on Damascus. He went back blind. And when Ananias came and prayed for him, his eyes were open. And Ananias said, God has called you to be a light to the Gentiles. And you will stand before kings and leaders, giving testimony of the name of the Lord Jesus. Wonderful to hear. The next thing you know, they're all trying to catch Paul, and because he was a murderer, hey, you are the one who killed many people, right? You're the one who killed the Christians. And so finally, they had to let him go in a basket, and he ran for his life. But that was important, because when he went, the foundation of his time in the desert happened. And that 14 odd years of silence, which nobody knew of, was a preparation for him. Right? And God brought him. Did he fulfill everything that God had told him to do? Yes. Did he stand before kings and leaders, and was he a light to the Gentile? Yes, he was. But he had to put the pieces together. Right? So each one of us, even as we draw out our plans and purposes, remember that sometimes it may not go always the way that we want it to go, but we journey along with God, right? So just a few things, points, and we'll close. You were made for a purpose. Discover it and live it, right? As you discover it, you live it. Foundation is what matters, what you build on, right? You know, even if you have already started, make changes to that foundation. Set certain principles right. Right? Three, your personal priorities, again, are foundational, right? Your character, your values, what you stand for, your attitudes, right? All of this is very, very important. Be clear of non-negotiables. There will be times when you know, you will be put between the fire and the deep sea. There will be a time when you may have to make a decision. Well, the wrong decision can make things smooth, but the right decision can make things get really bad. What are we going to do? Draw from your foundation. That's what Daniel did. And finally, develop a life plan, review it continuously, right? So even as we close today, I just want to encourage each one of us, right? If you already have a life plan and you're working on it, that's wonderful, right? Continue to review it, continue to make changes and see how God is working. But if you haven't done it, I want to encourage you, do it. Do it, write it down, open a Word doc, take some time. Pray, ask God, God, how should I do? What should I do? Right? The person, the place, and the purpose that God wants us to be. Right? Right. Any questions? Any thoughts? All right. All right. So before we close, this Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday is our Christian Leaders Conference in Bangalore. And so we will be there at the conference. So we will not have class on Wednesday. So of course, even the other lecturers will not be available because we all will be at the conference. So we will meet next week on Monday, and then we'll continue from chapter 2 onwards. I hope that's okay. All right, so let's close with a word of prayer. Maybe any one of us can please close in prayer. Lubega, Isaac, will be good to hear any of you pray, please.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come before you. We thank you for this wonderful new year, Lord. I also thank, Lord, for the gift of life you've given us, our colleagues, our pastor, and everybody in our families. Father, I also pray for the little ones or our colleagues who have not been able to join the group. Let us hope that they are fine and they will join next time. I also pray and believe that everything that you have taught us through the pastor, let it be adding and multiplying to your kingdom. I do pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Lubega. Thank you, everyone. So as I mentioned, we won't have class on Wednesday. I'll meet you next Monday. Have a great week ahead. God bless.
Thank you, Pastor.
God bless.
Thank you, Pastor.